I am Brother Stephen Elabo, welcoming you to Deeper Life Bible Church, Charlottesville, United States, a place where the undiluted Word of God is being preached. You are about to listen to our General Superintendent, Pastor W.F. Kumoye, as he comes forth to share the mind of God with you and your family. I want you to be ready. Pick up your pen and your paper and jot down important messages as they will do you good. God bless you and remain blessed.
Verse 19, having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus, by a new and living way, which he has consecrated for us, through the veil, that is to say, his flesh, and having an high priest over the house of God, let us draw near. We is a true heart, in full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled from an evil conscience, and our bodies washed with pure water. Let us hold fast the profession of our faith without wavering, for he is faithful that promised. As we come to the faith clinic this morning, want to talk about the blood of Jesus. The blood is shed for you. The blood is shed for me. And the blood is shed for the whole of humanity. We're looking at the benefits of his blood. The benefits of the blood of Jesus Christ. Effectively, the benefits of his death. The benefits of his sacrifice. The benefits of his provision coming from Calvary. Here he tells us, we now have boldness to enter into the holiest by the blood of Jesus. Look at that in verse 19 again. It's talking to the brethren. It's talking to the people that know the value, the efficacy of the blood of Jesus Christ. And it says, we have boldness. What gives us the boldness? Now we can come into the very presence of God, and we can come to the holiest place of the Lord. He's telling us we can come not just to the outer court of the sanctuary, not just to the premises of the sanctuary. We can come into the holy place itself. We can come into the holy of holies. We can come to the holiest. We can get saved. We can get sanctified. We can be made holy. We can be made godly and righteous. And we can have the power of God in our lives. Our boldness to claim the promises of the Lord. Having therefore, brethren, boldness to enter. And there is no uncertainty. There is no doubt. There is no unbelief. And there is no suggestion as if. What if it does not happen? What if we try to enter and we're driven back? It says we have the assurance to enter. We have the boldness to enter, and we have the promises of the Lord. We can easily come unto him, boldness to enter into the holiest. How do we do that? By the blood that saves, the blood that cleanses, the blood that transforms our lives, and the blood that provides all the benefits of redemption. Boldness to enter so that we can have that blood paving the way for us. And it goes on in verse 20. It says, it's by a new and living way, which he has consecrated, set apart for you and for me, for us. And it says, it's through the veil, that is to say, his flesh. The body was broken for you. The body was pierced for you. And the blood gushed out just for you. And it goes on to say, we now have him as our high priest. It stands between us and God. He represents God to us. And he represents us to God. He says, because of what he has done already, let us draw near with a true heart. We go back to Calvary. If there is any sin in our lives, we confess and we forsake. We get rid of them. And now we can come with a true heart, a clean heart, a pure heart, an honest heart, in full assurance of faith. That means there's no iota of doubt in us, because we have that full assurance of faith, having our hearts sprinkled, washed, cleansed, as with pure water. And then from evil conscience, we now have that boldness that not guilt nor condemnation can hinder. Let us hold fast then the profession declaration of our faith without wavering, because he is faithful that promised. As we come to chapter 9, Hebrews chapter 9, reading from verse 11. Hebrews chapter 9, verse 11. It says, but Christ being come and high priest of good things to come. Good things to come. In the sense that the blessings we receive in the new covenant, they're greater than the blessings they received in the old covenant. They had a lot. They received a lot. And they benefited a lot from the sacrifices they made, because God commanded them to make those sacrifices. And he gave them the promise that if this was done, he was going to also do that in their lives. And it says now that we in the new covenant, we have something greater, something higher, something more beautiful, something more wonderful. It says we have greater benefits. And those are the benefits we're looking at today. It says it's by greater and a more perfect tabernacle not made with hands. That is to say, not of this building. Verse 12, neither by the blood of goats and calves, but by his own blood he entered in once into the holy place, having obtained eternal redemption for us. He has obtained redemption for us. And he has obtained that redemption by that one sacrifice for generations after Calvary. For generations after he died on the cross of Calvary. Until this day, in fact, until we enter into eternity. For if the blood of bulls and of goats and the ashes of an heifer sprinkling the unclean sanctifies to the purifying of the flesh. Again, it's returning to the old covenant. And that if the blood of animals did the cleansing and did the conversion and did the purification at that time, how much more? In verse 14, how much more? It makes you to expect more from the blood of Jesus Christ. Makes you to expect more from the sacrifice of Jesus Christ than you could ever get under the old covenant. How much more shall the blood of Christ, who through the eternal spirit offered himself without spot to God, purge your conscience, purge your heart, purge your inner man, purge your spirit, purge your soul. How much more will the blood of Jesus Christ purge you and purge you internally to the point you're clean without any blemish at all, from dead works to serve the living God? It tells us in verse 22, verse 22, chapter 9, verse 22, and almost all things are by the law purged with blood, and without shedding of blood is no remission. It's talking about the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ. Without the shedding of the blood of Jesus Christ, it's no removal of sin, it's no remission, no forgiveness, it's no redemption, it's no salvation. Only through that blood can we have salvation today. We're looking at 3 points under this topic. Benefits through his blood. Number one, peace and pardon through his blood. Peace and pardon through his blood. The sinner is guilty. The sinner is condemned. There is no peace, says the Lord, to the wicked. How can you have peace then? How can you come into the peace of the Lord, into the peace of God, the peace that passes understanding, through the blood that is shed for you on the cross of Calvary? And pardon, he forgives, because except those sins are forgiven, the little ones and the big ones, the public ones and the private ones, the known ones and the secret ones, except they're pardoned, you will not be able to get to the kingdom of God. and so to have the salvation of the Lord, and to be so clear, so clean, and to be so prepared, you're able to enter. You need the pardon of the Lord, and that comes through the blood of Jesus. Peace and pardon through his blood. Number two, purity and power through his blood. Purity and power through his blood. He removes that Adamic nature. He removes that tendency to want to sin. He removes the liking to sin, the desire to sin, and purifies us so that we're not just holy and righteous externally, outwardly, but inwardly, we're holy. Inwardly, we're pure. Because he removes that sin within us that is very root of sin, the root of bitterness, and the root of evil. Purity and power through his blood. And then number three, we have protection and provision through his blood. All we need for this life, all we need for godliness, all we need to make us victorious in every way, he has given us through the blood of the Lamb. Protection and provision through his blood. We come to number one, peace and pardon through his blood. Peace and pardon through his blood. You understand how important peace is. Without peace, what can you do in life? You have a confused mind, an agitated mind, a condemned mind, a guilty soul, a guilty heart. How far can you go? If you are followed by the shadow of your sin, you cannot have peace. But when you come to the Lord Jesus Christ, turn away from that sin, repent of that sin, and then you apply to the efficacy and to the sufficiency of the blood of Jesus Christ, pardon comes and peace comes. In Romans chapter 3, Romans chapter 3, reading from verse 23, it says, for all have sinned, all have sinned. You have not all committed all the sins of the other people, but you have committed your own sins. Not everybody sins the same way. Different people commit different sins. And it says, all have sinned. The small, the great, the lowly, the high, the educated, the uneducated, all have sinned. And so everybody has become guilty. Sin brings guilt. Sin brings condemnation. Sin brings judgment. And sin attracts heaven's punishment. All have sinned, and so all are liable to the guilt, the condemnation, the punishment, and the judgment because of sin. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation, that means an atonement, an acceptable sacrifice, through faith in his blood. See that? Through faith in his blood. You understand? He died for you. He took your place. And because he died for you and he took your place, that's why you can have that peace. That's why you can have the pardon. It's through the atonement he made. It's through the sacrifice he made. You've come to the Lord. You're telling the Lord, I merit death. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. But I thank you, Lord, because you love me so much. And you sent Jesus Christ to take my place. Jesus Christ to be my substitute. He bore my sorrows. He bore my sin. He bore my punishment. He bore my evil. He bore the consequence of everything I have done. And because of that, because of that sacrifice, because of that substitution, and because of sin-bearing activity that happened on the cross, I can now come and I can take his place as he has taken my place. Look at it again from verse 24, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is in Christ Jesus, whom God set forth. It's God himself that appointed him, that set him forth, that ordained him and that approved him to be the propitiation, the sacrifice, the atonement, the redeemer through faith in his blood. As you have faith in his blood now, the benefit of Calvary comes to you. And the benefit of that forgiveness comes to you. The benefit of that redemption becomes yours. He says to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past. The sins you have committed in the past, the sins that are past, the sins you have dabbled into secretly or publicly, the sins of the past is now able to cleanse, is now able to remove, is now able to forgive, because you have faith in his blood. It says through the forbearance of God. To declare verse 26, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him that believeth in Jesus. What does that mean? That he might be just. What it means is, you committed sin, or you committed sins in the plural, and you are guilty for every one of them. You committed sin against the eternal law of God, the great law of God, the supernatural power of God, then has the ability to punish that sin with eternal punishment. And because you have come to Jesus and you tell the Almighty God, he bore my sin, Jesus has taken my sin away, God, to be just, can only punish sin once. And because he's punished on Christ, that sets you free. That's what it means, that he is just. And now he's the justifier of them that believe on the Lord Jesus Christ. Look at chapter 5, verse 1. Chapter 5, verse 1. Therefore, being justified by faith, remember, is the justifier of him that believes on the Lord Jesus Christ. Is the one that sets him free. He has believed on the Lord Jesus Christ. He was guilty, but because he applied unto the Heavenly Father, because of Jesus, on the merits of Jesus, on the sacrifice of Jesus, because of that, he is now justified. He believes, and justification has come. He will not be punished again. The Lord has taken the guilt and the condemnation away. Verse 1, chapter 5, therefore, being justified by faith, we have peace with God. Before that, to you, God was the judge. He was the one that will punish your sin. But now, because you have come through the blood, you have been pardoned, you have been forgiven. That sin has been taken away. The guilt is gone. The condemnation is gone. Because of that, now you see him as Father. And you have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ. Look at verse 6 there, that chapter 5. For when we were yet without strength, in due time, Christ died for the ungodly.